Hi everybody, it's me, Dr. Kestler from Lorain County Community College with another COVIDio. Today's April 3rd and my temperature is 96.4 Fahrenheit and 35.8 centigrade. I'm going to start with a question today. And first question I'm going to answer is this one here. Can you get COVID-19 twice? And I'm actually going to change that question up a little bit because I prefer to answer a different kind of a question. I'm going to answer it instead of can you, do you? And one of the things that I have learned in years of experience is that you can, in biology, you can never say anything absolutely. It's wrong to say something absolutely. What you have to do is you have to talk in probabilities. It's a much better thing. And so the question I'm going to answer is this. Do you get COVID-19 twice? And in the history of the world, the answer is no. And how can I say the history of the world? Well, we've been facing diseases, as I've mentioned in previous episodes, many, many times. And we have always gotten through it. So most people do not get an infectious disease twice. Could someone get an infectious disease twice? Why, yes. And that happens. There are some people who get the chicken pox twice. But for the most part, those of us get a disease, we get it once, we get immunity to it, and then we are, and then it's over. It's not an issue anymore. And that brings up the whole concept of vaccination. Of course, getting a disease and getting over it is a natural vaccination. So if you've got a childhood disease and you got over it, that's a natural vaccination. And I want to talk a little bit about some vaccines. We have some vaccines that are under development and are being evaluated right now, and we have great hope for them. And I want to talk about where does that come from? Where does this vaccine come from? So I'm going to have a little vaccine talk. Of course, vaccine is a big part of my past, but I'm going to talk a little bit about the word vaccine. I pulled this word, this definition from Webster's Dictionary, and the literal definition of vaccine is that which is derived from a cow. And the story comes from a guy by the name of Edward Jenner. Edward Jenner is, of course, the person who first created the first vaccine, and he invented this word. He stole this word and kind of put it together and created this word from a Latin word, vacca. Vacca means cow, and seen means that which is derived from a cow. And so the reason for that is, by the way, there is only one vaccine that has ever been used that is derived from a cow, and that vaccine came from a smallpox vaccine. So Edward Jenner came up with a vaccine. That's a picture of him, and you can see a cow in the background. He is a physician in England, and he noticed that smallpox is creeping into his world, coming from animals that were imported. That story has been repeated over and over and over again. That, of course, is also the COVID story. There was an animal, and that animal got exposed to a human where it wasn't before, and then this new disease jumped into a new population. And here we are with a million people infected with a virus, and more, by the way, on the way. We crossed a million yesterday, and we are moving very, very fast on that. So, and by the way, if you ever have a chance to read this Jenner's paper, it is amazing. It is, 222 years old. And it is very relevant and very readable. You just got to extract all the old English out of it. So Jenner comes up with the first vaccine by noticing that people who are exposed to horses contract smallpox. That's where it came from. The virus also jumped to cows, and people who were involved in the dairy industry developed poxes on their hands. So Jenner has this idea that he's going to take some of the, he notices that the people with the poxes on their hands do not develop the full body smallpox. I was going to show you some images of people with smallpox, but I chose not to because they are quite graphic. I would just say they're a very graphic kind of a thing when you get smallpox. Smallpox is, of course, the first disease ever eradicated by public health, and it's thanks to Edward Jenner's efforts. So he notices that the people with the cowpox, they have poxes on their hands, not their full body, and he theorizes that perhaps there's something positive about the contact with the cow. And then he takes a little bit of the pus from one of those wounds and he jabs it into his a young child and to try to see if they could protect that child. And of course that worked. And not of course that worked, that did work. And he repeated it. In fact, that has been repeated and repeated. I have a scar in my arm here where I was injected with cowpox. Most of you people who are not who are chronologically challenged, you do not have that scar because we stopped vaccinating in the 1970s because we eradicated smallpox, which is the greatest accomplishment of public health, is eradication of smallpox. Still, the next eradication I think will be will be polio, which we hope to we're very close to, and of course HIV disease. So that worked all by a vaccine. By this vaccine did in fact work. All right. Now the remainder of this, and hopefully we can get a vaccine for COVID as well. Remainder of this, I'm going to talk a little bit more about masks. Masks. The most unbelievable amount of email and posts and comments. People have been asking me about masks and effectiveness, yada, yada, yada. Lots and lots and lots. And the Centers for Disease Control has given somewhat of a mixed message about masks. And the reason is supply. Quite frankly, it's supply and demand. And the fact of the matter is we are a country where there is, and I'll talk about effectiveness in a second. We have a country where we don't have masks. The New England Patriots recently took their jet. And yes, the New England Patriots have their own personal jet. They flew to China and they picked up a whole bunch of masks to bring back to people in this country. We are missing it. So the reason that the CDC was not recommending masks is because they did not want people taking masks, especially the N95 masks, which are the most effective, from healthcare workers who desperately need them. And that's basically the whole story. Now, do masks work? And the answer is, yeah, they do work. I showed you this picture before of the guy from smallpox, the physician with the big duck beak on there. And that mask, I think when I was telling you my story about, not smallpox, that was the Black Plague. When I was telling you the story about the Black Plague, I said that this guy, that mask was not very effective. You know, he had flower petals in that mask and he was not having contact with people. But I got to tell you, that is a bit of an effective device. It's effective because that mask is actually keeping you in physical distance from people. It is reminding you that you have a mask on and people go, oh, I'm not going to go up close and talk to that guy because he's got that duck beak on. And it's also keeping you from touching your face, touching your mouth, keeps your hands away from there. And if you sneeze into that mask, your sneeze goes into that mask. And so you are, that is somewhat of a protection. A lot of discussion, and you saw in that question that was asked whether there was a difference between airborne and droplet. Let me show you a picture of the anatomy of a sneeze. This is what a sneeze looks like. And you can see there's some molecules there. Airborne versus droplet is about gravity. The whole story is about gravity. Heavier things will drop. That's droplet, and airborne means it kind of floats in the air, in the atmosphere. And if you're talking to somebody closely, there are particles that are being shared, and there is a little bit of a hang time before something actually does drop down. So wearing a mask is useful. But if you want to wear a mask, wear it all the time. when you're in contact, when you're out in public, and respect it. I've seen a lot of people do the, I want to be cool and wear a mask, but I'm going to take it off all the time and put it back on to show people your face. And so don't do that. Leave, if you're going to have a mask, wear it. It is a two-way protection. If you sneeze, your mist is not going to get out on other people. And talking also produces little teeny pieces of spit that come out of your mouth. And those little teeny pieces of spit can contain virus and get onto things. So wearing a mask can be useful in those kinds of ways. But I suggest that those of you who are making your own masks, do so. We can have mask making contests and make who can make the better mask, and that would be good. But don't use masks that can be used by healthcare professionals because they need them desperately first. All right. Last thing I want to talk about is just another question that people are constantly asking me, and that is when this is going to be over. We expect, if you look at this graph here, I have in the yellow line, I don't know if you can see the yellow line, but I have traced out a projection of where Ohio numbers are. You can see that Ohio was a few weeks ago, let's see, that's 10, about 10 days ago, was going up and up and up. And now we seem to be heading a little bit more of a curve, or more of an arc. Of course, we want that line to be parallel with the x-axis. That's our goal here. And when we hit peak, in my estimates here, is in about 2 weeks, is about 15 days or so. I see we are reaching peak. Now, of course, that's my projection. Real data changes everything. Real data can change things. You can go up or down. Yeah, where that ends up can change on a dime. All right, I'm going to, so we'll see how that goes and we'll see how everybody's doing. And of course, if we all stay in, the more we stay in, the better it is, the better off we are with respect to flattening that curve and going beyond. If we can stop the virus, stay in for a few more weeks after we stopped it, we could eliminate it. We still have a potential problem later. We still have to deal with this. We still have to work really hard. Yesterday, I told you about how we need to open up the research universities again and really push on this. We need to do that. And then we can move on from there. I'll remind you of what I've been saying all along. Remember to be good to each other. Look for the helpers. Be good to each other, and may you persist like a lentivirus. Thank you all for tuning in to the MicroProf Learning Network.